What's up, guys? Today I'll be showing a side-by-side comparison of the new iPhone 11 Pro Max with a $50,000 RED camera. I just want to let you know that this will be a very honest comparison, and in this video I'll also explain why the RED camera is so expensive and what makes it that way as we look at the side-by-side comparison. I would never suggest that you use the iPhone to replace the RED. They are different tools used for different purposes, but with the advances in technology with smartphones, more and more beginner filmmakers are finding out ways to use these phones as decent cameras until they're able to afford something a little bit more professional. In this video, I'll be comparing the dynamic range, color science, low light capabilities, depth of field, as well as each of the three lenses on the iPhone with similar focal lengths on the RED. We're gonna shoot this video at 4K 60 frames per second on the iPhone and 6K 60 frames per second on the RED. So without any further ado, here is the comparison video between the iPhone 11 Pro Max and a $50,000 RED camera. Let's see how fast you can figure out which camera is which. Alright, now let's begin to review this comparison video. As you could probably tell, the RED camera was the one on top. I was surprisingly impressed with the footage that I got with the iPhone 11. Once again, Apple has improved upon the camera system from the iPhone 10, and in perfect lighting conditions, when viewing on a compressed YouTube video from your phone, it can sometimes be hard to tell which is which, so it's pretty cool that it can even come close in certain situations, and fun to see smartphone cameras continuing to close the gap between low-end and high-end cameras. But as I'll explain in this video, there's still a lot of reasons why a cinema camera like the RED is still a far superior camera. Also, before I get into it, I want to say that I filmed the iPhone footage with the in-camera app. No third-party apps were used like Filmic Pro. I originally was going to use Filmic Pro, but after downloading it at the time of filming, the app didn't recognize the ultra-wide lens, but since then an update has come out where it does now recognize it. Alright, now on to the review. Some of you might say that the biggest difference is the resolution, with one being shot in 4K and the other one being shot in 6K, but that's actually not completely true. Resolution is important, but it wasn't the deciding factor in determining why the footage looks so different. So let's get into talking about each reason for why the RED outperforms the iPhone, and we're gonna start with dynamic range. Dynamic range is how well a camera maintains the shadows and the highlights in an image. This is measured by something called stops. The human eye, for example, is said to have 20 stops of dynamic range. The RED camera has 16.5 stops of dynamic range, and the iPhone has around 12 stops of dynamic range. So you can see here in this example that the RED maintains the quality in the highlights and in the shadows, whereas with the iPhone, the highlights are blown out and the shadows are crushed. And one of my favorite features of the RED is that since it shoots in RAW, you can actually go in and adjust the picture profile, if you will, of the RED to completely take advantage of the dynamic range. For about 90% of the time, I use a picture profile called RED Gamma 4, which makes the image the most contrasty. But every once in a while, if I see that the image is looking too contrasty, I'll do RED Gamma 2, which softens the highlights and brings up the shadows just a bit. Or if I want to take it to the extreme and really see all the dynamic range, I use RED Log Film, which really shows you how much detail is actually being captured in the shadows and in the highlights. So this software that RED has is one of the factors that makes it so pricey, whereas with the iPhone, once you film a video, that picture profile is baked into the shot. Now, something else that I notice with the iPhone footage is that they have a software built into the phone where it tries to make the footage appear like it has better dynamic range at times by adding an HDR effect, which is a cool software for some shots, but it can mess with the skin tones and make things look too HDR in other shots. So that's something else to be aware of if you're going to be shooting with the iPhone. The next thing I want to review between these two cameras is the color science. RED cameras are known for having colors that just look so good. A lot of times with other cameras, I've noticed skin tones will be off, or the greens may look kind of yellow, or there may be a bit of a purple hue to the image. But with a RED camera, you get almost true to life colors that are the closest thing to real life that I've ever seen outside of cameras like the Arri Alexa. Now, of course, if you're a master colorist, you can fix a lot of these issues in the other cameras, but time is money, and I don't want to spend more time trying to fix the colors that come out of my camera more than I have to. So what I notice with the iPhone colors is that they were a lot more saturated straight out of camera than RED's colors were. The skin tones were a lot more orange and sunburnt looking, and the greens had more of a yellow tint to them, whereas the greens on the RED camera looked lush and true to what we saw with our eyes. I tried to fix a lot of these colors in editing, but like I said before, it takes way more time to fix something in post than it does to get it right when shooting. So that's another reason why the RED is so expensive, is because it gets the colors right from the beginning. The next thing that makes these cameras so different is the depth of field. The sensor on the iPhone is so small that it's hard to get any shot with a good depth of field. Another frustrating thing with the iPhone is that it has a fixed aperture on each lens, whereas the RED has the ability to adjust your aperture depending on what lens you're using. I'm curious to see if Apple will ever come out with any future iPhones that will let you adjust the aperture, but I'm not sure how that would be possible with our current limitations. And this is something that will most likely always be a con for smartphone cameras because they can only make the sensors so big on those little phones, and unless they make much larger sensors, they will always struggle at giving you a shallow depth of field. So we can see here in this comparison that RED was able to produce images with a dreamy looking depth of field or background blur, whereas the iPhone was limited with its fixed aperture. Usually, the tighter the lens, the more depth of field you'll see. With wide lenses, it's easier to get everything in focus, which could be good or bad depending on what look you're going for. But as you can see here with this example, you can see such a better depth of field with the RED, which is another reason that it's about 50 times more expensive than the iPhone. And finally, I want to talk about the low light capabilities. Unfortunately, low light situations absolutely destroy the image on an iPhone. So if you're using this camera for video work, make sure there is plenty of light available. To be honest, the RED camera isn't even known for having great low light capabilities, but it still outperforms the iPhone in this category. Part of this reason is because we were shooting with lenses that had a lower aperture on the RED, which makes the image brighter, but most of the reason is just because the RED sensor handles the footage so much better and maintains the quality of the shadows, whereas the iPhone's image just falls apart and becomes really blocky and pixelated in low light situations. The iPhone 11 does have a night mode for photos. It's really awesome for shooting low light photos, but low light in video mode still isn't great. Also, it's worth noting that the new wide angle lens on the iPhone 11, though it's a great new addition, it isn't as high of quality as camera as the other two, and it becomes a lot more noticeable in low light situations. It does a lot worse in low light situations than the main camera, so even though I'm excited about having the wide angle camera on there, just be aware that it's not as high quality of an image, and it will really struggle in low light situations. So yes, I understand that this video was like comparing a Ferrari to a Honda Civic, but the point was to show the advancements in smartphone camera technology and how the gap between low-end and high-end cameras continues to close. Obviously, smartphones will never replace cinema cameras, but it's fun to show you certain situations where they can provide similarly stunning images, along with helping you to understand the limitations as well. And I hope this helps encourage all of you creators out there that can't afford nice cameras to get out there and shoot with the cameras that are already in your pocket. But that's it for this video. Huge thanks to the Jurgis for being in this video. They are a traveling adventure family who are currently on a quest to visit all 50 states. So if you want to follow their journey, go ahead and check them out. And also a big thanks to Amphibious Zoo for letting me use their music in this video. And if you'd like to receive more filmmaking videos like this one, be sure to hit that subscribe button and leave a like below for the YouTube algorithm. It really helps out the channel and it makes it so that I can create more videos like this. I'm also in the process of creating an online course that teaches you everything you need to know to become a pro filmmaker and make over 6 figures a year doing so. So if you want to be notified for when that course comes out, go ahead and sign up for our email list in the link in the description. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.